vino spumeggiante nel bicchiere scintillante come il riso dell'amante mi infonde il giubilo.
I'm sitting in the piazza del municipio of Sorano, the main piazza of Sorano, with Nonna, who is a grandmother and mother to many, many cats that live in and around the piazza. She appreciates sitting in this warm sun evening. It's the end of November, and there's a cold wind blowing. People have basically finished harvesting their olives and are making olive oil. And we are now looking forward to a few months of cold, bleak weather, but also Christmas and all the nice things that come with Christmas, one of which is the sfratto, which is a dessert that's made here in Sorano and has been made for centuries. We're going to visit with Mario Lupi today, who is the local pasticcere, the baker, pastry chef. He also has a bar that we're sitting out front of right now. And he learned how to make sfratti from his mother-in-law, passed down for generations. They're wonderful walnut and honey rolls. And as I say, he thinks of them as a Christmas treat. However, there's another story behind it all. And there's a lot of evidence to believe that it was in fact a Jewish dessert. Now, Sorano and Pitigliano had considerable Jewish populations. Back in 1555, Pope Paul IV wrote some anti-Semitic diatribes, and many Jews left from Rome. The Rome ghetto was established and many Jews left. Many were welcomed into Sorano and Pitigliano, the local town, by Count Niccolò Orsini. And to such a degree that Pitigliano is now known as Little Jerusalem, Piccolo Gerusalemme. However, the good times didn't last, and once the Medici took over, the Jews were not so welcome. A ghetto was also made in Sorano, and Jews were not doing terribly well for a period of time. So, the story is probably quite believable that a Jewish baker came up with the idea for the sfratto. Now, this is shaped in the form of a stick, or a baton, which was used to evict people from homes. They would go with a baton and hammer on the door. And so the name of this is a sfratto, which is the same word for eviction in Italian. The baton that was used to evict people from their homes was called a sfratto. People were sfrattati, evicted from their homes. Now, Mario, as I said, thinks of has a sweeter version of this tale, and there's no question that this is an old Soranese dessert from Sorano, and we're going to hear his version of the story. But so we're going to go right here and make some of these lovely walnut and honey rolls. So now we're entering into Bar Lupi, which curiously in 25 years really has not changed at all inside. With Nadia behind the bar and Mario in the kitchen. Quite comforting to have, actually. Nadia. Si, sono io. This is Marco, the Indian miner bird. Here we have Silvio, the parrot, who's keeping nice and warm near the oven, and Mario. Ciao Mario.
Ciao.
Ciao. Quindi sei qui da...
Dall'80.
Dall'80. E hai tutti questi macchinari
sì.
da quel periodo, però avevi la...
Li avevo prima.
Sì. So he had all of these wonderful machines that he uses probably now for 40 years, including this instrument for mixing dough. And so he had the bar elsewhere and then came here. Quando sei venuto? Nell'84?
Nell'80.
Nell'80.
Sono venuto qui.
So Mario came here in 1980 in this bar from another bar further down in town.
Dimmi, questa è la mescola?
La mescola che è del mio papà.
Ah, this is the spoon from his father that he made for Mario. And what he's done is he's got the honey on. It will cook. Once it comes to a boil, he'll turn down the flame and it will cook for 20 minutes. E quindi che dicevi?
Girando il miele, le mescole più piccole, l'ho rotte tante.
Ah.
Si rompevano.
Uh-huh.
Pertanto mio papà, quando vide che facevo questa operazione, fece questa bella mescola e che dura sono circa 30 anni.
Okay, so he's saying that he's had this spoon for 30 years. His father saw that the spoons that he used when he was mixing honey and other things kept breaking, so it made him a nice robust one. And that's the history of this lovely spoon.
Miele con la nostra robusta mescola.
And go the nuts and spices.
Iniziamo a girare. E per 10 minuti cuoceremo le noci con il miele.
And so for 10 minutes he cooks the nuts and the honey together using that wonderful robust spoon that his father made for me. Okay. Now he's adding 300 grams of finely ground breadcrumbs.
Quanti gradi?
100 gradi sono.
Yes, so it's 100 degrees Celsius approximately. Good and hot, needs to cool it off. Ciao. Ciao Silvio. Sì, sì, ci siamo. Ciao. So now Mario is rolling up the honey and walnut mix into these forms, which are called biki. Mario's now done about 100, as he said, of the biki, of the walnut and honey rolls. And as he was just saying, they're about 20 to 25 centimeters in length, because that's the size that he generally sells them at, but they can be any size one wants. They can be considerably shorter or much longer, and then cut into pieces once they've been cooked. Antonio has arrived, and we're now making the pasta in this wonderful old machine, which Mario has had for 40 anni, questa macchinaria.
Sì.
40-year-old wonderful mixing machine. And in there he's put 1 kilo of sugar, 400 grams of butter, 30 grammi di bicarbonato, 20 grams of bicarbonate of soda. In go 10 eggs to the mixture. 3 kilos of flour and about 800 grams of milk. The milk is used to render the dough a bit more elastic. Mario's running the dough through this machine, which serves to flatten the dough out to a certain point, and then he does the rest of the pan. But this certainly makes the process that much easier when doing large quantities. So the thickness is 1 millimeter. Then be enveloped in the dough. So Mario's mixed up an egg, and he's now painting it onto the top of the sfratti to give a nice color once they've been baked. And there we go. 200 degrees Celsius.
Il profumo degli sfratti è unico, è meraviglioso. Noci, miele e poi l'impasto con vaniglia e arancio è un profumo che è unico. Il sapore anche rimane unico.
So as Mario says, it's a unique combination of walnuts and honey and the dough cooking really is a unique and wonderful smell, and it tastes fabulous. Ooh. That's the first batch done. Mario is saying that this is, in his estimation, most definitely a Christmas treat, particularly as this is the time when walnuts are gathered.
La noce nuova è appunto fresca e pertanto la noce nuova viene raccolta a fine ottobre e noi di novembre iniziamo a fare gli sfratti.
So he's saying that the walnuts are collected at the end of October and then the walnuts are ready to be used at the beginning of November to start making the sfratti.
Nel 1621 viene fatto un matrimonio in fortezza.
In 1621 there was a wedding that was held up in the fortress.
Tra una contessa di Sorano e un conte di Pitigliano.
Between a countess from Sorano and a count from Pitigliano.
E appunto in questo matrimonio che venne fatto nel periodo natalizio, nel dicembre.
Ah, in fact, this wedding was held in late December.
Ecco, vennero presentati gli sfratti a questo matrimonio.
And so on that occasion, sfratti were presented, and this is the first written documentation of the sfratti. Now that we've made the sfratti, we're going to go down into the centro storico of Sorano, the historical center of town, to the old Jewish quarter where Antonio has his wine cellar. We'll sample the sfratti with a fine glass of Antonio's white wine. Looming above us is the fortress where the Count and Countess had their Christmas sfratti. We're now coming up to the Arco dei Ferini, the medieval entrance to the old town, and Mario, not only being an extraordinary pastry chef, is also a fine poet, and he's going to recite us a poem that he wrote about the old entrance.
Mitico arco che inviti le genti nel borgo dove il tempo si è fermato. Vie intricate, muri possenti che i nostri antenati ci hanno lasciato. Case arroccate, alcune cadenti che il fascino non hanno deturpato. Esce il turista, ringrazia Giocondo, ha visto il borgo più bello del mondo.
And here's the very poem that Mario just recited, attached below the archway.
Qui c'era la vecchia latteria di Giacinta.
Una latteria where they would sell milk.
Qui invece c'era il primo bar di Sorano.
Ah.
Era qui.
And now everything is shuttered. This was the old one of the first bars that was in Sorano. Here there was an old butcher, and then there was the barber shop.
Questa è la sinagoga dove c'era un'osteria dove tanti anni hanno venduto il vino, poi frutta e verdura.
And here was, as he was saying, was the synagogue, but it was then used for other purposes. It became an old restaurant, and then they sold wine here, and then it was a fruit and vegetable store. Now we're coming up to the Piazza della Chiesa and the Masso Leopoldino with its wonderful watchtower and clock. And here too, Mario was inspired to write a wonderful poem.
Bel baluardo posto in cima al masso, con quell'occhione ciglia e sopracciglia. L'or che ti fece il sasso sopra sasso, volle lasciarci questa meraviglia. Tu ci hai seguito a tutti, passo passo, tutto tu sai di ogni tua famiglia. Per ogni evento il tuo son non si colora, suoni per tutti la prima e l'ultima ora.
Bello.
Questa la piace insieme al Varo, eh?
Oh, questa l'abbiamo fatta a mezzo, eh?
Il Varo si
veniva
così.
No,
ho visto
a lui, ho detto,
chissà
che sta
a
fare.
Qui
c'era il mio bar.
Ah, this was where, this is now a ceramic shop, but this is where Mario had his original bar. And then he moved up into the main piazza of the town, outside of the historical center.
Che i primi sfratti Mario l'ha fatti qui.
Ah, the first of his sfratti he made in there. There's a cold wind blowing as we walk through this archway, which leads us to the area that was known as the ghetto, and to Antonio's cantina. Entriamo. Here we are at Antonio's cantina, where he makes an exceptionally fine white wine. I've spent quite a lot of time in this cantina, and in fact, Antonio's brother, who's now deceased, taught me how to make wine, and I would go to the vineyard where he had his grapes, and I helped him for many years. These are some photographs that I took of Antonio's brother Carlo and the Vendemmia when we did the grape harvest, probably 20 years ago. Now I'm going down with Antonio to fetch some wine to drink with the Sfratti, down into his gola. This is quite an impressive wine cellar, which was carved out of the tufa millennia ago. Antonio has his barrique, which are filled with really exceptionally good white wine that he makes. But we're going all the way down to the bottom to get the wine out of the steel container, which is much easier to dispense wine from. Now with the wine, back up we go. Bisogna tagliare i sfratti. Ups, con la mano, male. Che bello. È buono. Facciamo un brindisi.
Infatti.
A Mario, agli sfratti.
E agli sfratti.
E a tutti noi.
E a tutti noi. E a Sorano, chiaramente.
E a Sorano.
Ma che c'era una trattoria qui, Antonio?
And this just happens to be the front door of my house. But there was there was a trattoria here, and Antonio was saying, ma dicevi? And then there was another trattoria here. Ma tu dicevi che venivano tutti per questa strada? Dal nord venivano tutti qui. So everyone would come from the north of Sorano up this roadway, and so all of these doorways were filled with shops and merchants. Trattoria. Ciao!
Ciao Prince, ciao Prince!
Mario and Antonio and Sandro have gone back up to the bar. As I mentioned earlier, Antonio's cantina is at the beginning of the Via del Ghetto. And in fact, there's another plaque here with a poem, this time by Fiorella Bellumori, entitled The Ghetto. And this essentially is how it goes in English. The Ghetto. Your name is not glory, but it is immortalized in history, a cry that smites the universe to invoke the inflicted sacrifice of those ignorant of the conspiracy woven who yearned to live life.
towards the end of the Via del Ghetto, there was a Jewish bakery. And it is likely the first place where sfratti were made. At this point, in the 17th century, a gate was erected. It kept in those Jews that had not been evicted from Sorrento.